Hello my fellow gamers and welcome to another Was It Worth It video. This time around we are going to break down the Australian pack DLC for Planet Zoo. It came out on the 25th of August 2020 with a price tag of $10 or euros depending on your region. Its main features are 5 new animals for your zoos, 230 new scenery pieces to construct alongside the new foliage to plant in your gardens and habitats, new challenges waiting for you in the Tanami Roadside Zoo, and the Desert Oceania Sandbox Biome. My name is Peter, and if you're new to my channel, I want to welcome you and point you to a playlist full of guides, tutorials, and similar DLC overviews you can find up here on the right and in the description below. So let us first look at the new animals, as this is the heart and soul of each new pack. Since this one is themed by Australia, the players will get to house in their zoos the adorable koala, the predator scavenger dingo, the prolific and fast-breeding red kangaroo, Southern Cassowary, which is a large flightless bird, and the independent eastern blue-tongued lizard, which are not in the habit of caring for their young. The Queensland koala bear is probably one of the most iconic and easily recognizable Australian animals, and we have all seen just how fragile their ecosystem is in the Great Australian Fires of the 2019. They are solitary animals, but in nature, their home ranges often overlap and they will tolerate nearby koalas. They do not need strong or high fences and can survive in a wide range of temperatures from 8 to 42 degrees Celsius. They just need a bit of room to roam and some room to climb. Dingoes, on the other hand, do not need to climb but need a lot more room to be happy. The fences have to be better and taller than for koalas, and their livable temperature range is a bit smaller, between 12 and 40 degrees Celsius. You can set them up in small packs made up of unrelated individuals, a small family, or a medium-sized pack of up to 12 members. They do not live long and take a while to reproduce. The Southern Cassowary is a really cool looking bird, and it's a shame it cannot fly because it would look majestic in the skies. On the other hand, we wouldn't be able to set up a big enough habitat for it in our zoos, so visitors wouldn't get a chance to enjoy this beauty. These are solitary animals, so they will take up all the space in the habitat and they require quite a big one. They only need a level 2 fence to keep them safe and require no watered areas. The eastern blue-tongued lizard naturally fits into an exhibit and not a habitat. It has precise requirements for temperature from 25 up to 30 degrees and humidity between 50 and 60%. These are solitary animals and only interact to mate or fight over mates. Their young are independent from birth and they can mate right up until they die. Their signature blue tongue should be quite a nice attribute to attract even more guests to your zoos. The red kangaroo have large L-shaped back legs and small arms, large rabbit-like ears and a long face with a blunt snout which makes them easily recognizable, and like the koala, they're a major representative of the Australia's uniqueness. They like to live in a similar temperature range as dingoes, but require far less space for their habitat. These cuddly animals are actually quite dangerous if angered, and this is why you need a level 3 fence of at least 3 meters to keep your guests safe. Red kangaroos are social animals and often live in small mixed groups made up of an alpha male and many females, which reproduce quite quickly and often. Since each new pack brings the same amount of animals and costs the same, simple math shows us that players have to pay quite a bit more per animal when compared to the base game. However, since animals are not just skins, but also require new behaviors and animation patterns, we can try to overlook this expensiveness when coupled with the number of items and scenery pieces, which in this DLC is about 230. Now please do not mind me reminding you to hit that like button if you have been enjoying this video, and subscribe if you would like to see more videos such as this one. As I mentioned, besides the animals, we are getting a lot more construction and scenery pieces to make the Australia themed zoo unique and have a fitting environment for all the new animals and their habitats. Besides these, there are also new foliage and plants to make the animals feel right at home and dazzle your visitors with new species of vegetation. Players have already taken the new constructs and created some really unique and incredible looking habitats and buildings, which you can download off of the Steam Workshop and incorporate into your zoos. This is one way in which the community adds extra value to the DLC packs, and while they might seem a bit expensive compared to the base game, this helps soften the blow to your pockets. The Tanami Roadside Zoo Challenge features a rundown and broken zoo in need of a serious overhaul and upgrade. It actually features one of the animals from this pack, and it is available with no unlock requirements. For all players who enjoy picking up where somebody else left off and making a successful zoo out of a really bad situation, this is an awesome and interesting challenge. The new Desert Oceania Sandbox Biome is a truly unique and unforgiving experience because of its temperature and arid terrain. It will give you a real challenge if you want to introduce non-native species and keep them living comfortably in the unbearable Australian summers. When we add all of this up and look at the new zoos you can make with all of this content, it is hard to say that developers and publishers are asking too much for this pack. And on that note, I would like to thank them for letting me showcase and analyze this Australian pack DLC for you, my viewers, and help you decide do you want to get it now or later on a sale, because let's face it, who can say no to this face? Thank you for watching and happy gaming!